So we have attempted so far to look at the factors that have created integration in the financial market. And we also saw that this integration is not typically at the national level. It happens at the global level. We also saw that there was a very strong need and urge to have stability, but at times there could be financial instability or volatility which has to be managed. And from this, the forerunner to our discussion has been the fact that an integrated financial market needs stability and mechanisms to deal with that stability that we need, or mechanism to take corrective steps when instability is going to act as an impediment in the growth of the economy. For this, as the issue is global, the challenge is global, because instruments today tend to be global, markets tend to be global, movements tend to be global. So mechanisms or correction mechanisms, or what we call the corrective measures that we are looking for, is obviously global. It is in this context that we need to understand that we have something called Financial Sector Assessment Program, FSAP. Financial Sector Assessment Program is a joint initiative of the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank. Both these international agencies, the IMF as well as the World Bank, do their assessment programs for all the member nations, and they try to ensure stability. They try to ensure that whatever jolts, whatever volatility happens in the market does not impair the economy in a manner that it affects the common man, it affects the lives of the common people, it affects the economy on a very drastic note. Essentially, what they do is they try to undertake what we call stress test and risk management mechanisms. Stress test specifically focuses on the stressors in the financial sector. What are the factors which impose stress? Do we in fact face liquidity stress? Do we face stress in terms of speculation that happens? Do we face stress in terms of huge outflow of funds? Do we face stress in terms of excessive depreciation in the exchange rates? Do we face stress in our inability to meet the commitments of the economy, of the government, in terms of sovereign risk that stands out? So what are the stressors, and how these stressors are going to act as an imbalance in the economy is measured by such assessment programs. So also they undertake risk management measures. And together this, both the risk management measures as well as the stress test, would support a system which maintains your financial stability, which does not create an imbalance between financial markets in one country and financial markets in another, or which does not jeopardize the entire system in a significant way. Now with this, we have seen that a market that is integrated, a market that supports global business models, is so very important. Now let us move to another crucial area, and this is that of financial inclusion. A major objective of a financial market is to ensure access for its products and services to all the stakeholders or all the common men of a particular country. More specifically, the less privileged, the less organized, the low income group, the weaker sections of the society. So here we need to discuss a bit about financial inclusion. Financial inclusion is ensuring access to the financial products and services to the masses at large. And when you talk about the masses at large, what comes to our mind is the masses which are less organized, the masses in our community, in our nation, who are less privileged. For them, credit is a problem because of a numerous number of reasons. The very fact that they are unorganized will indicate that perhaps they are not fully literate, they are lacking in terms of skills, they are lacking in terms of access to income, they are lacking in terms of proper employment, and this keeps them away from the mainstream. Now, how do you ensure credit to such a group? The underlying philosophy here is, for an economy, for a nation which is growing, inclusive growth, inclusiveness, and inclusivity for economic growth is crucial. Our fundamental parameters for measuring financial inclusion is just the use of a bank account. All those who have a bank account are considered to be financially included in banking terms. But on a wider perspective, when we talk about inclusiveness, when we talk about growth in the economy, it does not just mean access to mere banking products in the form of an account, although that is a basic factor. Now, to ensure this basic inclusiveness, our government from time to time have taken steps. We have recently the Jan Dhan account, which talks about dealing with those people who do not have an account. First see that they have an account, first bring them into a bank account, and then see that they get advantage of the numerous support services which encourage them to take up their own enterprise, take up their own activity, which could even be agro-based business enterprises or mere agriculture. So we are trying to use finance as a tool to ensure transformation, to ensure sustainable economic development. And this again requires a kind of financial market which supports the same. Now, we need to understand the reasons for exclusion. When we say financial inclusion is so important for our economy, we need to know what could be the factors that lead to exclusion. Why there is a state where we have exclusion, specifically for a country like India? And I think the key factor is the urban-rural divide that India has. The urban-rural divide in India is there in many factors. When you travel through one part of the country and reach another end of the country, you might pass through cities which are very developed in terms of huge highways, excellent telecom connectivity, huge buildings and structures around, all kinds of modern financial services present there, all kinds of modern life supporting activities going on. You have excellent educational institutions, you have excellent kind of health institutions. But on the other side, when you travel through some villages in the same country, perhaps even 10 to 20 kilometers away from the limits of a city, you see cluster of huts. There are no roads. They hardly have a primary health center. There are very few educational institutions. And the level of literacy there, leave alone financial literacy, even the general literacy that we talk about in terms of reading and writing, is very poor. So there is a huge divide between urban and rural India. And this makes rural access to credit, rural access to financial services, rural access to the financial market a crucial issue. You find, if you look at the number of DMAT accounts in rural area, the number of bank accounts in rural area, the number of insurance services in the rural area, the number of retail investors, high net worth investors in the rural area, there is a big divide. So the rural poor, the rural underprivileged, who, leave alone, we are talking about the advanced telecom facilities, perhaps are even lacking in terms of basic infrastructure like power and drinking water. Such a population are kept out of the financial system, are kept out of the financial market, and have little access to credit, insurance, mutual fund, and all other services. So this is an untapped area which prevents the growth of the economy, and that is one among the major reasons for having exclusion in the market. Yet another reason is the huge unorganized sector. If you look at India's organized sector and the unorganized sector, we will find that it extends even to a percentage which is greater than 80. That means a significant majority of our people are unskilled workers who are not properly employed, who are agriculture workers. And such people live in rural area, and their number is very, very large. And they are to a large extent exploited as well. So this is another reason where you have low levels of inclusion or very high levels of exclusion. The low literacy is another factor which contributes to exclusion, because people do not know to read and write. They can't understand financial markets. They can't understand the literature that is talking about them in terms of assessing risk, understanding risk management practices, because they are away in terms of literacy. So obviously, information asymmetry is likely to prevail over there. The digital divide in India is also significant, because when we talk of the internet penetration, digital penetration, still the divide is significant, because it's still perhaps one third or even less than that, which means we need to invest significantly on our digital infrastructure. Only then the electronic platform, the electronic financial system would be active. As long as digital access is denied, there is a huge element of exclusion among those to whom it is denied over there. The gap in infrastructure development is yet another factor which creates exclusion. Because if you talk about areas where there are no road access, if you talk about a hilly terrain or excluded islands where there are no banks or no financial service providers there, then they are obviously excluded. And this arises because of the absence of infrastructure in such places, in terms of power, in terms of telecom, in terms of connectivity, and the gap that is standing there is very, very significant. So this is yet another important factor which creates exclusion in the economy of ours. We have another reason that we can talk about is the access that is there to the financial instruments which are there in the market. We do not see the same levels of access to all financial institutions. We are trying to massify this access to institutions and instruments by making it accessible to those who have kept away, those who are in the unorganized sector, those who are less privileged for that matter. Yet another reason for exclusion is the complex procedures that you have, because in order to ensure that we don't have black money in the economy, in order to ensure that we have the right kind of transparent dealings, we ask for a lot of compliances, specifically in the form of KYC, Know Your Customers, which says that you need to come with these set of documents, which can be an Aadhaar card, your name proof, your age proof, your identity proof, so on and so forth. And the unorganized sector is finding it difficult to produce all these documents. So what we need to understand is the factors that lead to exclusion is essentially low levels of social growth. India has to significantly improve upon its human development index. India has to significantly improve upon its infrastructure facility. And when that takes place, obviously we reach heights where inclusion is possible. And another offshoot of exclusion is that when you have an unorganized sector who lack access to formal credit, a basic problem that we face in India is the presence of informal credit, the presence of private money lenders who charge exorbitant rates of interest, who exploit individuals significantly, and that is another crucial factor which has had its impact due to exclusion from the financial system. Now, how are we promoting financial inclusion? What are the steps taken by institutions in India, the regulators of our financial system, in order to ensure or in order to promote financial inclusion? We have a system of banking correspondence. Now, this BCs, or the system of banking correspondence, It talks about the financial service providers going into places where access in the form of formal institution is not available. They go deep into villages, they go deep into hillsides, they go deep into islands which are isolated, and they act as agents for financial institutions. They go to the home of these rural masses, get their accounts filled, help them to open an account and ensure access there. So BC is one among the initiatives to ensure proper credit for that matter. Yet another model that RBI talks about is replacing of brick and mortar model with what we call the mouse and click model. It simply means that instead of having a place and a time based dealing in financial services, we move into a system where we do it online. So it is done in a digital platform, and that digital platform ensures a greater access, it ensures greater possibility for seeing that you are included in this particular model of dealing with this. Easing KYC is yet another measure that is contemplated by the banking sector in order to ensure access. Some of the other measures is promoting financial literacy. Earlier we were referring to regulatory agencies taking a number of steps to ensure financial literacy. The RBI is directly involved in financial literacy promotion measures. It also undertakes such measures through the banks and the branches over the network that they have across the country. Regulators like the Security Exchange Board of India, the Pension Fund Regulatory Development Authority, Insurance Regulatory Development Authority, in their respective fields, they promote financial literacy. IRDA in the insurance sector, SEBI in the capital market and the mutual fund sector, and the Pension Fund Development Regulatory Authority on the management and the use of pension funds. So the idea here is, when you come to know the market, when you come to know the do's and don'ts of investment, you tend to develop an affinity to save. You tend to understand what is in the offing for a layman, for an underprivileged, for a low income group, and how they can take advantage of that by using the services in the financial sector. Small finance banks and the payment banks are other measures through which greater access is being ensured under initiatives in the banking sector. Now, before we look at the stability measures, or before we come into a conclusive linkage between stability measures and business models that are there in the financial system, we need to draw some lessons, or we need to learn some lessons in terms of the global crisis. Because all throughout, we were trying to say, look at how integrated the market is and what is its global relationship. To understand this best, it will be beneficial for us to take examples out of the crisis in the financial sector which has had a global impact. The principal among them was the subprime crisis. Now, what is the subprime crisis talking about? The subprime crisis originated in USA. It happened towards the latter part of the first decade in 2000. And it was a case where we created bubbles of growth. And through creation of such bubbles, we created a sense of destabilizing the financial system. There were some entities which indulged and wanted to have a huge deployment of funds, and as a result of that, there was a crisis, and that crisis spilled over into the entire financial system, not just of one country, but the entire globe. So it is a case where you have a global impact. Let us try and understand what exactly happened. The idea or the whole thing happened as we were looking into an outcome of the imbalance which was there in the financial market and in the economy. US faced a situation where their banks were flush with funds. We were earlier looking into a situation of disintermediation. What they saw was their industry for project finance started having a situation where there was absolutely very less or no dependence on banks. So, industrial finance was not going out from the banking system. Banks had huge inflow of funds in the form of deposits, but they were finding it difficult to park their funds as industrial offtake was very low. Under such circumstances, the option that they saw, the way out that they looked into was retail finance. And the most attractive form that they found was to seek housing finance. So they went on in search of housing finance, customers who needed housing finance. They created a huge demand for housing finance under the impression that they would get this as a means to give credit with a collateral as security, because land would be there as a security. So they started organizing huge events where offtake of credit for housing was hosted. So lots of funds were pumped into the sector, housing sector. There was huge demand for housing. The price of land went up, and when the price of lands went up, again the banking system said your land is now having more value, so why don't you pledge this land and again take loan. So it was a huge pumping of housing loans into a sector where housing was not much in demand. Now, as a result of this, there was something which we call as subprime. Subprime talks about a system which can best be understood when you compare what is happening in India with what happened at that point of time in US. In India, if a customer wants a house loan or a home loan, what they do is they go to a bank. Your credentials are proved before the bank, and you tell your bank that your take-home salary is this, and based on your take-home salary, the banker will give you the terms and conditions under which the loan is available. The loan is available at what at that point of time was called the prime lending rate for housing. And if you do not fit in to the prime lending conditions of the banker in India, you will not get credit. That means there is nothing like subprime. If you have your salary, if you have your income support based on the rate that is prevailing in India at that point of time for housing, you are given a loan. So say for instance, the lending rate of the banker is 7%, and they cite a case where they say you can take a loan which is 50 times or 60 times your take home salary. So at 7%, based on your salary income, the loan is sanctioned. You are a prime customer under the prime lending system. Now what happened in US vis-a-vis what is happening in India was a parallel to this, where there was a huge subprime. A customer coming there talks about his situation, and the moment you see that the customer is not fitting into the prime conditions, maybe because of lack of income, lack of asset backing or other conditions, the banker will direct you to the subprime counter. The banker will tell you that you do not fit into the prime segment of our lending conditions for housing finance. But then you are not denied credit. You are still given an opportunity to get credit under the subprime market, which operates within the same system under which the banking system operates. So in the subprime segment, the extent to which you go subprime, that means the extent to which you do not meet the conditions, the rate of interest charged across the counter is high. So banks found this to be very attractive. They gave credit to customers who in fact do not deserve credit in terms of creditworthiness. They call them subprime. And because they were less creditworthy, they charged high interest. Now they were saying, we have a huge segment of borrowers, a huge segment of assets in the banking terminology, assets which are backed by high rate of interest. But the problem here was the customer's creditworthiness was not assessed, the customer's creditworthiness was not evaluated, and this segment grew in alarming proportion. And this is the subprime segment which the US had. Now, what happened over a period of time? When the default started, when the loans were not coming up as promised, we had problems. Here there is an issue where you gave loans to the parties to whom you did not have a direct relationship on in terms of creditworthiness and credit appraisal. Now the banks knew that some of their customers are going to be bad. They are not going to get the money back. So in order to hedge out the risk, what they did was they first created mortgage-backed securities on the basis of these loans. And they securitized, they indulged in a process of called securitization or selling all these assets to a larger financial institution, which is called securitization. They indulged in securitization, they created mortgage-backed securities on the backing of these loans. And this was being traded. The trading initially started under a vision, under a doctrine that all these securities are backed by home loans and much of these loans carry an attractive rate of interest in their market. So it was selling. Now it is at this point of time that many loan borrowers created default. Money did not come back. And immediately when this happened, even the good customers stopped paying. The price of land significantly depleted. And banks were left with a lot of security in the form of land, which did not have value. This could best be understood when you imagine a case where you have tens of thousands of such customers who have borrowed and are not repaying. And what the bank has is the security which they had as collateral in the form of land and that land not having an adequate value. This happening on one side. On the other side, what happened? The mortgage-backed securities which were trading in the exchange, because this information spread got observed there, it lost value. And the merchant bankers, the bankers who had securitized this, they had transferred their assets to big merchant bankers. These merchant bankers lost their liquidity. They were finding it extremely difficult to liquidate or get back the money on which they had securitized the loans. And again, look at this spillover impact. Again, what happened? What happened at this stage was when the spillover impact carried over, these merchant bankers are typically the foreign institutional investors who invest across the globe. The liquidity crisis that spilled over left these FIIs with little money. So they immediately started selling whatever securities they had in different stock markets across the globe. And as a result of that, we saw the global crisis capital market across the globe crashing, including that of India. We saw our BSE Sensex, the Nifty, crashing by 15 to 20% during that time when the subprime crisis was prevailing. And we saw its economic impact spill over. Once you have capital markets crashing, you see a significant decline in the number of IPOs, the primary market also showing its impact there. When you have a significant decline in IPOs, you see that project finance is not forthcoming. And because the financial market is at its lowest ebb, new projects cannot be undertaken by the industry. There was significant decline in investment and production in almost all the sectors of the economy, and we faced a massive recession. Fortunately, it did not affect India to the tune to which it affected financial markets across, because our subprime segment was relatively low. But we had our impact. We saw around 20% decline as far as the rupee is concerned in its depreciation. we saw a huge depletion in the financial reserves, the foreign exchange reserves that we have. We saw significant decline in production. Now, what is the lesson that we need to learn? The lesson that comes here is, you cannot use a financial entity in the market and using that financial entity alone create artificial demand and try to spill over its impact on the other segments of the financial market. Now, when that is done, its impact is so severe that you cannot always correct it without having its damage done on the economy. This is why we talk about stability. This is why we talk about managing volatility. This is why we talk about ensuring good governance, good practices, your stress relieving, your stress test mechanisms, your risk management mechanisms in the market. And these are the lessons that we learned from there. If you look at a similar lesson that we have learned earlier in the 90s from the Asian crisis, that was an issue between, or that was an issue of convertibility of exchange. Now, the concept there was, we were looking at an economic model where we said we will do all that is possible to ensure free flow of capital from other nations. So, the Asian tigers, the nations which were categorized as Asian tigers, they looked at an economic model where we are going to attract finance from other countries to have a free flow into our country, into our nation. So, what they did, let us open up the economy, let us make our currency freely convertible both on the capital and revenue account. Now, the lesson that we learned there in the 90s was, those nations, India did not have a full convertibility, and we do not have a full convertibility, but those nations which had a full, made their economy convertible, sorry, made their currency convertible on both the capital and revenue account, full convertibility they ensured, their proposition was there would be lots of money from other nations coming into the economy. It will create more production, more employment, more income and economic growth. But once they opened this up, what they found was, there was a huge deployment of funds into these nations for starting business and new enterprises. Now, the first thing that they did for starting such enterprises was the purchase of land. And the huge search for land created a surge in the price of land. And most of these enterprises which came from other nations, they understood once they have purchased land, the price of land skyrocketed and the best business now was not to do business and just sell off your land. So they, instead of starting off with production which would create employment, income, investment and so on, they just came into the economy, purchased land, and when the price of land increased, they sold off their land and left the country. There was a huge flight of capital which created a crisis. So the Asian crisis that we had in 90s and the subprime crisis that we had originating from US in the latter half of 2000, the first decade of 2000, it all teaches us a lesson on how to look at the financial system and the financial services as a support mechanism, as an integral part of a macroeconomic system, and thereby safeguard its activities, not to just infuse artificial bubbles, because such bubbles would burst at any point of time. So financial stability then is something which is of prime importance and significance, because we understand that an economy cannot subsist or cannot exist without such a kind of system. Here when we look at the financial market or when we look at financial institutions, they are all, as we saw, interwoven, interconnected, and they are all doing activities which are seeking funds, which are deploying funds, which are supporting economic activities, and they all have a final outcome which is related to the economy. Now, when that outcome is not seen in the right perspective, we have problems. And what exactly is that right perspective? That right perspective is a perspective which is drawn upon the philosophy of sustainable development. Sustainable development talks of sustaining all systems which gets integrated into your macroeconomic framework. We need to sustain that. And it is sustenance right from the grassroots level. It is because of that we looked at financial inclusion. It is because of that we looked at stress test. It is because of that we looked at risk management. So right from the grassroots level to all the sectors, into all the aspects of our economy, we need to see that it is sustained. And if any of these entities are indulging in activities which are not sustainable, it talks about the collapse of the financial system. Now, this has happened in some nook and corners of the country because, as we saw towards the beginning, we have specialized, unspecialized institutions in the market. We have organized and unorganized institutions. We have parallel institutions. Though in India, our subprime is not prevalent in the organized financial market, we have a parallel system where we have private money lenders, private microfinance institutions. They all do private activities which are not directly connected with the main activity. So they indulge in all kinds of activity where they offer very huge rate of interest and give loans at very huge rate of interest. They offer huge rate on deposits, lend at huge rate to the borrowers, and they thereby deceive. So then when they have deceived, we have seen its impact spill over to many sectors. It is this understanding that there is a parallel economy, there is a black segment, there is a hidden segment, which we need to correct, and we need to bring the entire financial market in with its sub-elements into a main system that ensures sustainable economic